led by the nation's top rusher, Alex Smith. So don't run away. It's Indiana and was
kicking off for the Indiana Hoosiers will be Bill Monolopoulos, and he's a good one, particularly in kicking for points. Rashawn Early and Raphael Cooper are back to receive the opening kick. And it's Early near the goal line. Room along the sideline. Rashawn Early across the 30, cuts upfield. One man to beat, and it's the kicker. Rashawn Early across the 30, inside the 20, hauled out of bounds at the 18-yard line. And Bill Monolopoulos, the kicker, an all-Big Ten kicker, exactly. Proved that he's a pretty good tackler as well.
Oh, that's Rashawn Early. I've been telling him all year here. That's my man. I mean, he just has that ability, that breakaway exciting ability, and you just can't get the ball in his hands enough.
Well, we got a flag on the play. Looks like they're bringing it back. Did not even see that come down.
I didn't see that flag either. They don't tell me they snuck one in on us.
The flag dropped at the 20-yard line, which means the Gophers, instead of operating deep in Indiana territory, will have to start deep in their own territory.
One thing I've noticed, they have been kicking away from Rashawn Early. In fact, I think he's number two in the nation also in kickoff returns. And some of the teams have been kicking away, but that's the very reason. I can understand it.
Well, the Gophers hope that this is not an omen. You get a great return from Rashawn Early. And instead of starting at the Indiana 18, the Gophers will start from their own 9. And as Mike Max mentioned, Tim Shade will start at quarterback.
Psychologically, that can put Indiana back on its heels a little bit. Let's hope they can get some momentum going right away here.
Darkins, of course, the lone back for Minnesota. And a bootleg. Shade throws to the far side, complete to Levine. And Levine across the 20 to the 21-yard line, and a Gopher first down. Tony Levine not feeling well. He woke up today with a fever of 101, but he's in the starting lineup and makes a fine reception there. And already this game is getting off to a better start than last week. The Gophers offensively line up this way. Levine in the flanker spot in place of Johnny Woodson. Mark Tang in the tight end. The Gophers operate now from the 21. This time Darkins takes the handoff. Very little running room up the middle. Gain of maybe a yard or two. John Hammerstein, left defensive tackle, made the hit for the Hoosiers. And it'll be second down and 8.
2-yard gain on the play. Second down.
There you see the defensive alignment for Bill Mallory. Alfonso Thurman, tremendous linebacker for the Hoosiers. This is a rebuilt Indiana defense. They lost 9 starters from a year ago.
I believe they were 10th in the nation in defense a year ago.
Darkins breaks one tackle. Finally, he's shouldered out of bounds by Derek Terrell. Middle linebacker for Indiana, and the Gophers will have a 3rd and 7 facing them.
The Gopher running game seems to be struggling the last few weeks. I'm not sure what it is. It looks like they're not getting enough push on the offensive line. They got penetration right away, and that'll kill you.
You're right, Keith. They did get penetration that time. I've been looking. That great play that in the first series, it was a great matter of deception. That Tim Shade made a great fake on the first play because they were key in Darkins.
Darkins on the draw across the 30, and he's got a Gopher first down out to the 32-yard line.
Nice call. I like that call. You've got to get Chris out in the open there, and that was a nice way to do it. Get that pass rushing defensive lineman coming upfield and turn him around.
Right there, Keith.
Super job by Jesuits at the center.
Jim Wacker mixing up the calls here in the first quarter. Throwing on first down back at the 8, and on a 3rd and 7, the Gophers catch the Hoosiers by surprise and send Chris Darkins on a draw for a first down. Now the officials have an issue to discuss.
I'm hoping that kickoff return, even though it did. Here we go.
Please reset the 25-second clock. to 25 seconds and the game clock to 13:51.
Decipher that, interpret that for us, Dick.
Well, they're going to add 10 seconds to the clock. Apparently the clock kept running after the first down was picked up. So now we're set to play. The Gophers working the ball out to the 33. Nobody in the backfield on first down. On a sneak right up the middle, and Shane's got running room out near midfield. Nobody home, and the Gophers pick up another first down.
Beautiful job. They moved the middle linebacker out of there when they saw no running backs in the backfield. It was wide open for a quarterback draw.
Oh, that was a great run by Tim Shade there. He got as much as he could and didn't even slide.
That may be an automatic for Tim, too. When he sees it, just take it.
Gophers have already picked up 41 yards on this possession. Darkins in the backfield. And again on the delay handoff. He's hit at the line of scrimmage. No gain on the play. Making the play for Indiana as they come off the pile. Trevor Wilmot.
Looked like the defensive tackles pretty much stayed at home, but that's going to keep their pass rush. That'll keep their pass rush under control. If they have to think about that draw, they've had two successful draws run against them now. They might take a little steam out of their sails.
You're right, Keith. That'll keep them where they're kind of looking rather than just playing recklessly.
Shade throws off to the left side, complete to Woodson across the 45 near another Gopher first down. Johnny Woodson, who had a very difficult time of it last weekend in Manhattan, Kansas, to say the least. It's nice for him to catch that first ball thrown to him this afternoon.
I was talking to Bob DeBest, the offensive coordinator, before the game, and I said, what do you say to a young guy that is having some trouble catching the ball? He said, you don't say anything. It's just like a running back. You don't even mention the word fumble if they're having some trouble fumbling the ball. They've got to work it out. That's the only way they're going to be able to do it.
Gophers trying to sustain a drive. They'll need to convert here on third and short. Darkins gets the call, and he's hit behind the line. That is held shy of first down yardage. Alfonso Thurman came up from his linebacking spot. He's been their top tackler the last 2 years as a middle linebacker. They moved him to the outside this year, and he comes up with a big play there.
He's had some big plays all year. He had a 97-yard TD return, interception return against Miami of Ohio earlier this year. Big play linebacker.
Yes, he and Trevor Wilmot both are outstanding linebackers and have made some outstanding plays.
Mike Kimball kicking and knocked out of bounds and hit late. Eddie Beatty, and a flag is thrown. So the first two penalties go against Minnesota.
That was an unnecessary penalty, but I question whether that referee needed to throw that flag. I think he reacted more to the crowd because he certainly wasn't given a hard shot.
Personal foul against the kicking team, 15 yards.
So the Hoosiers get better field position now as a result of the second Minnesota penalty early in this game. You can see Beatty right there is out of bounds.
He threw a little bit in there.
So Chuck Rios who hit him a little late.
I think a bigger concern is that punt. That was an awful punt, almost a line drive punt. That's dangerous when you give
32, 255 yards, and the Hoosiers in one of those close ball games that Minnesota lost last year ended up beating the Gophers at the Metrodome. Hoosiers run out of the eye, and there's Alex Smith, the outstanding freshman, barreling forward, getting to the 40-yard line. Tackled by Peter Hestand. Here's the ball-carrying, ball-handling alignment for Bill Mallory. Fullback is Steve Lee. He doesn't run the ball at all. Offensive line. And Alex Smith, who, despite the troubles Indiana had last year, is still still number two in the nation in rushing. All kinds of time for Pacey. He throws across the middle and hits Ajimo Stoner, redshirt sophomore from Louisville. A little bit shy of first down yardage. Again, Peter Hestand in on the tackle for Minnesota. And here's the defensive alignment for the Gophers. They played pretty well last week, despite losing 35-0.
Langford had another big game last week, leading tackler.
I'll tell you, Keith, I'm really looking forward to a highly competitive and exciting Big Ten football game today. Both of these teams are in that mode where they want it, they need it, but they really got to have it, you know? And so I'm looking forward to see which team is going to step up and make that assertion.
Oh, bobbled snap, and Smith is swallowed up as he approached the line of scrimmage. He leaned forward, but it looks as if he's a little bit short of first down yardage. In on the tackle for Minnesota, Ed Hawthorne and Craig Sauer, and we'll have a measurement here on Indiana's first possession. A little misfire here on the snap.
It sure was. That left guard was offsides. They had kind of a different defensive alignment there, too. They didn't have a down lineman over either the right guard or the right tackle on that play.
Basie almost pulled out of there a little too quick, also.
The left guard fired a little early, too.
I was going to blame the quarterback, but they rarely took the blame, so
that's why I had to step
I'm glad you mentioned it.
Just why I had to step up, Keith. I saw it coming.
Well, Bill Mallory is faced with a decision here as they have about a foot to go for first down. Ball near midfield, and the fans approve of Mallory's decision to go for it here on fourth down.
I think you go to Alex Smith here, don't you think, Sandy?
Yes, it would be a pretty good bet to look for him. Or the quarterback sneak, either one.
Pacey tries it, and he leans forward.
Gonna be close.
And he will be very close to a first down.
That's what happens when you let the crowd call your plays, though. They always want you to go for it, but that really was a punting situation. This early in the game, no score, and they took a big chance there.
I don't think they have it.
I think they do.
I think you're right.
Change your mind that quickly?
Yeah. I was looking at the wrong marker there, I believe. This could be a huge, huge play, obviously.
By the length of the football, a first down.
Your eyes are better than mine, Dick.
So the Hoosiers convert on fourth down. John Pacey, a senior. He missed spring practice with some shoulder problems. He missed a game and a half last year because of a dislocated shoulder. Had some surgery done on the shoulder. He's ready to go for his senior season and has played very well for the Hoosiers. In motion is Eric Matthews. Smith keeps his legs churning and gets out near midfield. Rick making the stop for Minnesota was Peter Hiestand, the linebacker. And Jerome Davis.
Super job that time by Jerome Davis, controlling the line of scrimmage, not getting any penetration, not getting pushed back where Alex Smith, he had to make his move 3 yards in the backfield trying to get around there.
You're right, Keith. That defensive line strung that play out beautifully that time.
Second and long. Pacey to the air for the second time. It's complete to Eddie Beatty, and he's tumbled out of bounds across the 35 to the 34-yard line. Justin Konzemius, Crawford Jordan in on the tackle for Minnesota.
Pacey took a pretty good hit right after he threw the ball here. The Gophers got there a little late.
See on the replay, just it was a crossing pattern. They executed well. That was a well-executed play by the Indiana team.
Konzemius finally spun him out of bounds, so now the Hoosiers are driving to try to get the game's first score. Pacey to Smith, across the 30 to the 26-yard line. Finally shouldered to the turf by Crawford Jordan. The top three running backs for Indiana all are averaging 7 or more yards per carry. And Smith, even though the Hoosiers struggled offensively last week,
still has his average 7 yards a carry, which for a freshman is, for anybody, is remarkable.
Remarkable, you're right, Dick, and to have two other guys backing you up with a 7 yard average, again, that shows a great running game.
He had almost 221 yards against Kentucky. That helps the average a little bit.
Smith hit at the line. He falls forward for a gain of a couple. Might have another Indiana first down. Justin Consemius again finishing him off.
They're going to keep Pound and Smith at that Gopher defensive line. And apparently they think they're going to wear him down. And that's what happens with a great back. You can hold him down for a bit. It's tough to put him away. Gophers are going to have to get the offense back on the field, give themselves a break here on defense.
Time of possession was a big factor in last Saturday's loss to Kansas State. The Gopher defense simply was on the field too long. Now this first drive by the Hoosiers is a prolonged one. Smith hit chin to chin and driven backward. Hawthorne was waiting for him at the 22-yard line.
Super job by Hawthorne here. Plugged up the line of scrimmage, got rid of his blocker. Shed his blocker. Here it is right now. Looks like he fought through the double team and got in there. Nice hit.
That's his outstanding play all across that defensive line. Yeah. Everybody had their position, and that's what you have to do. Especially with an outstanding running back. Everyone has to stay at home.
Third down, a handoff to Sean Glover. He gets across the 20, about the 18-yard line. Sean Glover getting a carry.
There's Mark Dove on the sidelines. He's done a super job, really, of turning this defense around. They really struggled, really got beat up bad against Penn State the first game, but they have been improving every game. They replaced a lot of guys after that Penn State game. Langford being one of them that stepped in and has done a super job.
Third and six now for the Hoosiers.
Big play.
Smith spun down at the 20-yard line. Great penetration by the right defensive front for Minnesota, and that means Jerome Davis.
Yeah, Jerome Davis pushed his guy into the backfield. That's what you got to have. If you can have some penetration like that, it cuts down all the running lanes for the offensive back.
In fact, Alex Smith tripped over his own man, I believe. We'll see here on the replay, but I believe his own man from being pushed back. There it is. He trips over his own man from the pressure Davis had on him.
They tried to pull the left guard there, and he ran into Davis's guy that he was putting into the backfield.
Bill Monolopoulos will try to kick the first points through. Up and good from 37 yards. Monolopoulos, an all-conference kicker in 1993, puts Indiana in front, 3-0. Monolopoulos will kick it away for the Hoosiers. Early, to the left of your screen, and Raphael Cooper to the right. Will have to take over at the 20-yard line.
That's one way to defend the long run back. Don't give them an opportunity.
Yeah, Keith, as I mentioned at the beginning of the program, both of their kicking game is just outstanding. They're among the nation's best in both kicking and the punting aspects of the game, which is invaluable to your team. They're a well-rounded football team.
And Shade will start the second Gopher possession. Difficult Saturday night last Saturday in Manhattan, Kansas. Jerkins gets the ball on first down. They string it out and spin him down for a 4-yard loss. First man there for Indiana was Lewis Pennick, defensive end.
They tried to get around the outside that time. They've got to find a way to get Darkins in that backfield. He's really dangerous, and that looked like Kansas State from last week, the way they strung out that line there. The Gophers have to take care of the charge of this game early here. They had a good chance last time, but like previous games, they marched down there and didn't get any score.
The tight end was trying to hook Pinnock there and did not get a successful block.
Second and 14 for the Gophers. Shade, deep deep across the middle. It's complete to the 35, and it's Levine across the 40 to the 41-yard line. Joey Elams finally knocked him down. A wobbly pass, but it was on target. Last week, the Gophers couldn't catch the spirals. Maybe that was the key. Passes were too good last week.
Beautiful pass here. Nice catch by Levine. They need a receiver to make some plays tonight. Tim Shade struggled last week, but I was talking to Bob DeBest before the game, and he said he's a take charge kind of guy, and they need that kind of spirit on the offensive team.
That's what your quarterback leader has to do.
Darkens with a roll.
That's what
across midfield, across the 45 to the 42-yard line. Lance Brown, the last man there, made the tackle. Nice carry of the day for Chris Darkens.
Nice run up the middle here. I think we're going to see a replay. Nice run up the middle. They've been trying to get around the ends with Chris. Right here, they can't come right up the middle. Nice block. Nice block by the right guard that time.
Outstanding hold from Keith. Just
what
I'd
Brian made a nice block and got him through there. You've got to get Chris Darkens 5 yards into the backfield because he can make a lot of things happen out there.
Exactly, Chris.
An injured Indiana player being helped off the field. Trevor Wilmot. Outstanding linebacker. And as we mentioned, the Hoosiers are trying to get by with a rebuilt defense this year. They had a very good defensive club last year. They lost 9 starters. And today they will have to play without one of their top defensive linemen.
They rebuilt the entire defensive backfield. Let's hope the Gophers can't take advantage of it. Shade seems to be on target tonight and is not today compared to last week.
Troy Drake, one of the starters back from last year's defensive team, is out with a bad knee. So they've got an inexperienced defense, and on first down, Shade overthrows the intended receiver by plenty. Pass was intended for Javon Jackson, who's in at a flanker spot for Minnesota. Jackson's been used as a tailback. Maybe we'll see Jackson split wide a bit more frequently with the emergence of Raphael Cooper in the backfield.
Well, we want to see a good sustained drive now by the Gophers. They've taken their time. They haven't made any foolish mistakes here. And they just have to take their time and drive right down here, but get some points. They have to come out of here with some points.
Shade again across the middle, incomplete. Knocked down by Derek Terrell. Pass intended for Chuck Rios.
Looked like that pass fell short, obviously. It looked like if he could have given it a little more time, Rios would have came open deep.
Yeah, he looked like he was coming open down the middle there, if he did, right there.
Yeah.
Third and 10 for Minnesota.
Shade audibling again.
Just get the playoff. Shade with time. Wide sets open. It incomplete. Intended for Thelwell. Thrown a little bit behind him. And now the Gophers will be faced with a 4th and 10.
Tough catch, but you got to come up with those.
It's a little bit behind him there, but like you say, Keith, you've got to make those catches.
Flag down on the play.
Offsides on the defense.
And the Gophers will get 5 yards on another third down. So the first penalty against Indiana, at least for now, keeps the Gopher drive alive. The right defensive end, Nathan Davis, almost got back across the line of scrimmage, but the flag was thrown.
Good poise by Verdeen and Thoman, not jumping when they see the defensive guy false start like that.
See if the Gophers can take advantage of the break here.
That quarterback sneak is there again for Shade if he wants that quarterback draw.
He'll throw. Complete to Rios. A Gopher first down across the 30 to the 29-yard line. Alfonso Thurman finally shoves him out of bounds, so the Gophers take advantage of the penalty and extend their longest drive of the ball game.
I was glad to see that. That was their bread and butter play. Rios coming underneath again, right across, makes a great catch, the kind you have to have. He's been doing that every game, though. You can't say enough about Chuck Rios. He's played consistently, one of the few who played consistently well every week.
Motion is tanging. Darkins gets the call, cut back, and not much room there. Reggie Bryant hit him as he got to the line of scrimmage. Darkins picked up maybe a couple of yards. The Gophers this year have had more success running the ball than in years past under Jim Wacker. In fact, coming into the game, a few more yards gained on the ground than through the air, which is almost sacrilegious in Jim Wacker's offensive scheme of things.
That shows some of the patience that he's had with the running game, but also the impatience he's had with a floundering passing game.
And also a great back like Darkins, you do want to get the ball in his hands as much as possible.
Shade throws to the near sideline. It's complete to the 22-yard line. Osterman coming into the ball game for Minnesota, playing with that soft cast on that right wrist. He broke his wrist in the second game of the year against Pacific and has had to play with a broken bone. He plays with during practice with a hard cast and a soft cast on game day.
That was a great catch. Even with two good hands, that would have been a great catch.
Third down and three for the Gophers. Javon Jackson tries the outside. And he'll be a couple of yards short. Great penetration along the right side of the Indiana defense. Lance Brown came up from his safety spot to finally knock down Javon Jackson. The Gophers will bring Mike Schalberg into the ballgame.
Good job by Hammerstein and Pinnock, too, of not letting them get any penetration here. Extending the line of scrimmage out far enough where they could get some help from the defensive backs coming up, the linebackers.
The Gophers are just not going to be able to run wide, it doesn't seem, on anybody. Keith,
they've had some problems.
With the single back, though, you're strung out, and there's just no deception there. You have to have that something to hold those backs so you can get around that end.
39-yard attempt for Schalberg. He's 9 of 10 this year. It's blocked. And covered at the third. No, it's not. It's still alive. Now out to the 43-yard line. The Hoosiers come up with a big kick block. John Hammerstein, apparently the Hoosier, to come through and knock down Schalberg's kick.
That is really a killer as far as psychologically. You get a decent drive where you're going to be able to pick up at least 3 points, and then you have it blocked.
High snap. The kick was blocked, and it was John Hammerstein who blocked it for the Hoosiers. Alex Smith gets the first down carry across the 45 to the 47. Maybe the 48, a pickup of 4 or 5 yards. Spun down there by Doyle Cockrell of the Gophers.
I think they have kept Smith pretty well contained up to this point. They haven't let him break through any great big ones and haven't let him really get his confidence up, which is what you want to do, especially with a freshman there. Put some wood on him.
That kid had 3,000 yards his senior year. That would have been 3,000 yards in a high school career is pretty good, but he had 3,000 in his senior year.
He's an Indiana boy.
Mr. Indiana.
Pacey will run across midfield. He's got a first down to the Gopher 43-yard line. Let's go down to the sidelines and Mike Max.
Well, we've chronicled Alex Smith. He's trying to become the fourth running back in Big Ten history, the fourth freshman running back in Big Ten history to rush for over 1,000 yards. One of the previous running backs was Mike Harmaker from Indiana. The other two, very familiar to Minnesota. Robert Smith at Ohio State, now with the Minnesota Vikings, and Darrell Thompson, who set the record with 1,240 yards as a Minnesota Gopher, of course. And Scott Eckers was just warming up. It looks like he'll go in at quarterback for the second quarter.
There you see the 1,000-yard freshman runners. Smith on a reverse.
Wide open.
And it is wide open. Nobody there at all. Jama Stoner cuts inside and scores a touchdown.
I've talked about about it time after time that misdirection will do it. In fact, Minnesota needs to do more of that. I've been urging them to do more of that themselves. That's why everyone's stringing out on Darkens. You have to have something coming back around there.
The final play of the first quarter, and it's a 43-yard reverse for Ijamo Stoner.
They had enough penetration there where they almost disrupted it, where they didn't get the handoff off. But
the first quarter score, Indiana 10, the Gophers nothing, as Metalopoulos kicks it through, and a big, big play for the Hoosiers here late in the first quarter.
You can see Alex Smith barely got that handoff off.
Oh, they set this play up beautifully. It was well executed. Minnesota wasn't at fault. They were in there trying to get great penetration over there. They've been stopping Smith all day, but they took advantage of it and just countered with a beautiful reverse and
a blocked kick. And the Gophers need to get something established offensively. They've now gone more than five quarters without scoring a point.
Indiana's up by 10. It's hot, and it just got about 10 degrees hotter on the Gophers sideline. You don't want to get behind in this kind of weather.
Well, yes, one of the opening, at the beginning of the game, I thought the Gophers had to take charge of this game, Keith, from the very beginning. When you're in a way game especially, you have to get in there and dampen the spirit of that crowd and the team and let them know that you're in for a long day. If they think that they can get up on you right quick and start doing the dance on you, then it's a long day.
Manolopoulos will kick it away. And Early and Cooper are back for Minnesota.
We've got the potential for some big special teams plays on the Gophers' part with these guys returning their kick.
A high, short kick. Taking at the 23. And the Gophers will start at the 27. Jamie Beasley making the hit on Ben Langford, who caught the high end-over-end kick.
Langford did a good job there. He didn't try to be fancy. He didn't try to run it. Just protected that football. Made sure he caught it first and then protected that football. That was a super play. You get those linebackers catching the balls, and they want to...
Scott Eckers, who last year had a great second half against the Hoosiers. He replaced Tim Shade at halftime last year. And he'll start the second quarter at quarterback. Eckers across the middle, complete. Say incomplete. 2-2 Atwell had it, dropped it. Aaron Warnicke hit him hard near the 45-yard line.
Yeah, that's kind of frustrating to Scott coming just in the game there. Atwell has to hold on that ball. That looked like shades of last week there, but you've got to catch those balls, and the defense put a great hit on him.
Second and 10 for Minnesota. Eckers started the first couple ball games, did not play well. Win the quarterback spot. Darkens with a huge hole across the 40 to the 42. Finally tackled by Joey Elams.
Super job by Bertine and Rick Thome in making a nice quick corner there. Offensive line got some nice push. Here it is right now. Good reaction by the tight end too.
Also, by Eckers coming in, it wasn't that Tim Shade did anything wrong in the first quarter. It's just the coach made his mind up beforehand that he was going to use both quarterbacks here until he sees what happened in the second half.
Eckers spins away from a tackler and gets back out to the 41, close to the line of scrimmage. How in the world did he stay on his feet?
That was outstanding presence by Eckers that time. He could have tried to throw the ball up and threw it in somebody else's hands. He kept on to it and eventually broke away.
First man there was Nathan Davis. Alfonso Thurman finally wrapped him up. Trevor Wilmot in on the tackle for Indiana as well. Rios
Indiana.
Greg Rios might have sprained his ankle a little bit there, but he's tough. He's going on back in the huddle there.
Rios has had some ankle problems this year. Knee problems held him out of spring practice. Gophers trying to break into Hoosier territory for the third time in this first half. Third and three. Eckers throws complete to Atwell, and he falls out of bounds for a Gopher first down. Make it Ryan Thelwell, who made the grab at the 43-yard line.
Tough catch for Thelwell. That was a nice job.
Yeah, Tutu made up for that one he missed on that one. That was a tough catch. Eckers really drilled it in there to him, but he made the catch it.
Ryan Thelwell getting a Gopher first down. So far, so good for Scott Eckers. A couple of first downs on this possession. Barzaloskis, who just had his red shirt pulled off of him this morning, made the tackle, a freshman for Indiana. If you'd like to pick up Golden Gopher tickets, you can call the Gopher Ticket Hotline at 624-8080 or 1-800-U-GOPHER. McKinley Boston, the athletic director, saying that a lot of fans have picked up tickets for homecoming coming up against Northwestern. Gophers are hoping for another crowd of over 50,000 for that game in 2 weeks. Second and seven for the Gophers. Movement on the line again and contact this time. Victor Alote came across the line, but this time the penalty will go against Minnesota, I believe.
Dead ball, false start on the offense, 5 yards, still second out.
Those kind of penalties will just kill an offense. You start getting some momentum going.
Eric Dalen, the tight end, was the guilty player. Second and 13 for the Gophers. Nobody in the backfield. Eckers audibly. Deep across the middle, incomplete, almost picked off, intended for Atwell. And Alfonso Thurman almost picked the ball off.
He's very fortunate not to have that one picked off, Dick. He threw it right there in his hands. He has to throw it out leading. If his man doesn't get the ball, you have to throw it so nobody gets it.
Thelwell did a nice job of going through the defender there, too, in an attempt to get the ball. That could have been dangerous. That was dangerous.
He broke it up well. He broke it up well, which is what he's supposed to do. If he can't get it, nobody's supposed to get it.
Third and 13. Shade to Darkins across the 40. To the 35, a first down across the 30 to the 26-yard line.
Great
Darkins
effort.
Darkins making just his fifth reception of the year.
Great effort by Darkins running through those tacklers.
Outstanding running by Darkins. This is what I've been anticipating the whole time. You've got to find, if the running's not working, then you have to get him out here on screens, reverses, wide pitches, whatever it takes to get him into the backfield. He's just such an outstanding runner. You just got to find a way to get him in that backfield.
Not just today, but all year long, the Gophers have been stifled in this part of the football field on their offensive possession. Javon Jackson gets a first down carry out to the 22. John Hammerstein is there for Indiana, but this has been a trouble spot for Minnesota. Chalberg has kicked a lot of field goals when Gopher drives have been stopped in this part of the football field.
And first down is important. If you can get 4 or 5 yards like the Gophers just did on that first down, that the play selection is so much better. The things you can choose from.
Second and six. To the sideline, complete to Thelwell. Go for first down to the 11-yard line.
Now that looked looked like a football team executing a play right there.
I know it's early, but Shea didn't do a bad job in the first quarter. Eckers is doing a good job in the second quarter. Who do you go to in the second half? Because both quarterbacks are playing well.
They both moved the ball down the field real well. But we'll see here if anyone comes away with some points.
Yeah,
that might be one determining factor.
Aaron Ulsterman into the game for Minnesota. Johnny Woodson. On a first down, 10 call for Minnesota. Jackson with a hole across the 10, the 5, down to the 1 yard line.
Beautiful run, beautiful cutback by Jackson.
Great second effort also. He tried his best to get in there, and that's what a back's supposed to do. He reached out, Keith, and tried to get that ball in there and for the touchdown.
Jackson frustrated because he got to the 1 yard line. Now he has to be taken out of the ball game with Chris Darkins, who will likely get the call here.
Again, look at this. You can see
he's
the push.
Trying his best.
You can see the push by the offensive line. Jackson could cut back by about when he was 3 yards deep into the Indiana backfield.
In fact, the ref brought him back a little further than he should have been. If you look at that replay, he was a lot closer than that.
First and goal, Gophers. Eckers fumbles the ball. Hold down, and now he fumbles the ball out of bounds at the 45-yard line of Minnesota.
Deja vu all over again, huh? Penn State again.
My goodness.
Fumbling right on the goal line.
Well, that makes your decision for you a little easier, too. I can't believe it.
Inside the 1 yard line on a first and goal. And Eckers couldn't handle the snap. And it goes the other way, and the Hoosiers have a chance to break it open when we return. Lead it 10 to nothing. With the ball now fumbled by Smith, and the Gophers cover it up in midfield. Alex Smith could not handle the pitch out. Ogun Akbar covered it up for the Gophers.
Somebody's got to get mad on that sidelines when you have the kind of drive that the Gophers just have had getting down to the 1 yard line. Somebody's mad, and hopefully the defense got things turned around here.
Well, I'll tell you what, Chris Darkins was really mad. He made an outstanding. He really stopped that from being a touchdown on that recovery, and he was being blocked even, and still went through the block.
Was kind of a two-on-one coming up field after the Minnesota fumble. Lance Brown took the pitch, and Darkins stayed with him, and now with the turnover back to the Gophers. That tackle by Chris Darkins may be one of the biggest plays of this football game. Here's the pitch.
This
to
is
Lance
one of the
Brown.
This might be one of the biggest plays. Look at that effort
at that.
By Darkins.
One hand.
He was tackling both players there.
That was
an outstanding effort.
And actually caused him to fumble the ball, too. If he'd have been out in the field, there'd have been a chance to get it back.
Such a great defensive effort, not that long ago, and Chris Darkins will start this possession on the sideline.
Well, the Gophers really were fortunate in that turnabout of play, but that's what the game of football is about. You're going to have those plays. You can't get down. They're still very much in this football game. You still have to go down there and get a score.
I think this is going to be the key drive of the game. If the Gophers can drive down there again after the disappointing fumble that they just had, they could get right back in this ball game. But they've got to get the ball in the end zone on this drive.
Or at least come away with some points.
At least 3 points.
9:36 left in the half. The Gophers have made some critical mistakes again here in this first half. Eckers brings him to the line. Jackson with another big hole. Across the 40, Javon Jackson shoved out of bounds at the 30-yard line. A pickup of 20 yards on first down for Javon Jackson.
Again, you're seeing the push by the offensive line. When you can have a running back decide to cut back when he's 3 yards deep in the Indiana backfield, that's where you're going to get some big plays. Beautiful job by the left guard.
Nice cut to the outside by the running back also. Shifts that ball in the left hand where it's supposed to be and gives a little stiff arm as he goes out of bounds.
This is an Indiana defense that was run ragged last weekend against the Badgers. They gave up 62 points. Now the Gophers trying to exploit the Indiana defense. Darkins picks up about 2 yards along the right side. Mike Max is down along the Gopher sideline.
Well, what's missing from this game that we saw at the Metrodome last year are two key players. Thomas Lewis, wide receiver for Indiana. Omar Douglas, wide receiver for the Gophers. Lewis was drafted in the first round by the New York Giants. Douglas signed as a free agent. Both made the team. In fact, they were roommates during training camp this year. One other note, Scott Eckers almost missed this possession. He was on the phone. Tim Shade had to grab him and shove him onto the field.
Shade's got to learn to run out there himself. Let the guy stay on the phone.
To the sideline, wide open is Thelwell. He got it near the 20, and we'll see where they mark forward progress. He might have another Gopher first down. They will give him a pretty good mark and an apparent Gopher first down. Chris Mucci finally knocked him backwards. A first down for the Gophers.
That was making another great reception here. I also love the way that Scott Eckers is delivering that ball, though. He has great rotation on it and sitting in that pocket, and he's throwing a beautiful ball. Look at that.
Rotation's the key, isn't it, Sam?
Well, no, you just got to have some hands.
Don't be talking rotation. You got to have some hands. You're confusing.
You got to have some hands. If it's a Joe Cap ball, you still got to catch it.
First and 10 Gophers from the Indiana 20. Darkins to the short side. He's got a hole. Cuts inside. 15, 10, 5.
That's a touchdown.
Touchdown, Gophers.
That's a touchdown. All effort. I told you he was mad at the end of that last play there.
He saved a big touchdown on a tackle near midfield a few moments ago. Now he takes it in from 20, and it's a 10-6 game.
This showed a lot of character, this drive. Great offensive line play again. Got good push on the Indiana. Look at that corner. That corner is 3 yards downfield before he has to make the turn.
The man caught him at 7-yard line, and Darkins just hauled him for 7 yards. He was determined to get in there. Nothing was going to stop him from getting to that goal line, and that's the way you run the ball.
Schalberg for an extra point attempt. Up and good, and the Gophers come up with an awfully big touchdown with 8:23 left in the half. It's 10-7 Indiana.
And they're fortunate enough to get the ball right back on a great play by the defense.
Garrison Harmon will kick it away for Minnesota. Taken deep in the end zone by Eric Matthews, and he'll down it there, and the Hoosiers will start at the 20-yard line.
Outstanding kickoff there by the Minnesota. Look at this. You can watch this all day. Basically makes a good fake there, good footwork. 48's on him. His determination, he carried him for 7 yards right in the end zone.
Dan Brooks, the young sophomore tackle, made a great block on the right side there for Darkins.
A good first half so far for Darkins. And the Gopher defense with a chance to stiffen up here, maybe get the offense the ball in good field position. Macy throwing deep to the sideline. It's complete. Across the 40 to the 45-yard line. Ben Klusmeyer, the tight end, made the grab, and just like that, the Hoosiers have it near midfield. Hoosiers don't throw to their tight ends very often, and the Gophers may have been caught by surprise here.
Fine effort on the tackle there. That could have been worse than it ended up being.
Justin Kanzemius finally hauled him down. Instant field position for Indiana. Pacey screams left. And up near midfield, Sean Glover. Finally knocked down by Hestand of Minnesota.
Well played by Stan. He played that out there, and it could have went either way, and he kept it inside of him and waited for his help to come.
Pacey, again a senior. Had some shoulder problems last year, has played some of his better games against Minnesota the last couple of years. Have not seen Chris Ditto, who we expect to see sometime during the game today. They split duty during the season so far. Penalty flag down on the play and a good stand by the Gophers as Sean Glover was pinned behind the line by Ogun Akbar.
Great penetration again by Akbar. If you can cut down on the lanes that running back has to choose from, it makes all the difference in the world. That gives you a chance to get your pursuit there.
You're right, Keith, and because of that, because Minnesota has done such an outstanding job of that today, Smith really hadn't been a factor in this first half.
Not yet.
An illegal motion call against Indiana will probably be refused since the Gophers got a four-yard loss on the play anyway.
On the offense, decline, third down.
And the Hoosiers are now faced with a third and long. Pacey.
This could be a pivotal play right here. They come up and stop him on his third down, make him punt it, and get the ball back and then make another drive here. That could sway the middle factor for him for the day there, Keith.
They've got to be careful with Pacey, too. They got to get a good pass rush, but he can run the ball, too. He's a good scrambler.
Ditto's more the drop back pass, as Dick explained earlier, but Pacey will run on it. I love a running quarterback.
Third and nine. Pacey chased out of the pocket. He'll try to run for it. Knocked out of bounds near midfield. A great play by Craig Sauer, because if Sauer had not hit Pacey hard enough to knock him out of bounds, he had the whole sideline to run along.
Great penetration by the defense again. That threw it. They got him flushed out of the pocket. And a great play by Sauer on the sideline.
Sauer made a great play there. And you're right, Dick. If he hadn't hit him, he might still be running. I just told you, those running quarterbacks, that's the one thing they can do. They add extra added dimension.
Rodney Heath back to receive the first Indiana punt.
I bet you we don't have a fair catch.
Fumble.
Oh, he didn't.
Flag is down. He did not have the necessary 3 yards cushion. And I think the Gophers will survive Rodney Heath's fumble here at the 15-yard line.
Yeah, he has to give him plenty, a lot more room than he gave him there. And you knew Heath wasn't going to fair catch.
I was just going to say.
He's got that ice through his veins.
I was just going to say, we're waiting for our first one. That's the first one we've had to watch today. We always enjoy watching Rodney. That's the one exciting part of the Gophers
foul,
play.
Interference with the opportunity to catch the kick on the kicking team. 15 yards from the flag. First down.
.646 left in the first half. The Gophers will start with the ball at the 30-yard line. They survived a missed punt by Rodney Heath, but the penalty for interfering with the return has moved the ball from the 15 to the 30-yard line.
Indiana team on the heels by making an established drive, consistent all the way down the field.
Eckers, quick pass to Woodson across the 30. Cuts to the outside and works his way out to the 38-yard line. We talked about it from a Minnesota perspective when the Gopher defense was on the field a lot in the first quarter, but now the Indiana defense has had to spend a lot of time on that hot artificial turf.
It could be a factor, too, Dick, later on in the game, because they're wearing them down and wearing them down. And if you keep wearing them down, and then I look for Chris Darkins to really break loose, maybe in the second half here.
Second down and two. It's Darkins, swallowed at the 37-yard line. Lewis Pinnock was right there for a loss of about a yard.
Great play by Pinnock that time, coming around the backside.
That was good penetration by the Indiana team that time. We'll see how they come right across.
Yeah, they weren't even blocking that backside defensive lineman. For some reason, either somebody missed an assignment or the play just developed later or slower than they expected. There was nobody blocking them.
They've got to get this first down here. This is a very crucial first down. They don't want to get the ball and just turn it right back over to Indiana and let them run down and get a score before half here. It could upset the whole equilibrium here.
Pinnock, a senior in school. He's a redshirt junior, so he'll be back next year. This is an Indiana team that returns just about everybody next year. So even though they may be struggling at times this year on defense, next year they should be a better team. Big third down call here for the Gophers. Eckers throws it across, complete, across the midfield stripe to Rios into Indiana territory at the 47. A nice pump fake by Scott Eckers.
I don't think that was a pump fake. I think he was going outside, and it was covered, and he kept his poise and went to a secondary receiver. That was a super play.
That was great awareness.
I think he was sending it out there.
Great awareness by Eckers. Exactly, Keith. He was looking out there, and he kept his poise and didn't just throw it. He held it back and looked for a secondary receiver.
Gophers doing a much better job today converting third down situations. Bob DeBess, the offensive coordinator for the Gophers, pleased with the way his offensive line is dominating play right now. This is the freshman Cooper. He steps over a couple people and crashes forward to the 40-yard line. I was interested in listening to Jim Wacker earlier in the week saying that Raphael Cooper has the best raw talent of any Gopher running back. Now, that's saying something when you've got a Chris Darkins on your team.
I was talking to Bob DeBest before the game, and I said, do you think some of Cooper's runs were a result of Kansas having some second stringers in? He said, no, he was doing some things that you don't see running backs do.
Kept out of the first three games, and finally had his red shirt taken off last week. Second and short. Eckers rolls out. Zips it to Thelwell at the 30-yard line. He's hit hard, but he hangs on for a Gopher first down, a flag down on the play. Offsides against the defense, so that penalty will be declined, and the Gopher drive stays alive. Eric Smedley finally knocked Thelwell out of bounds. Thelwell, another freshman, is doing well. You can see the bottom of your screen there. It was Jason Kaler, I believe, who was lined up offside.
Yeah, he was lined up offside, Dick. You're exactly right.
Good job by the Gopher offensive line again. They're exploding off the ball. They're not just sitting there and making it. They make it look like a run, and that helps carry the fake out. It's not just a fake with the quarterback and the running back.
4 minutes to play in the half. Reverse it to Rios. And he's pinned down at the 30-yard line. A great job by Lance Brown. He stayed home and let Rios come to him.
That's all right. They tried it, though. Rios, they need a little more speed with someone running that play, but Rios is steady, and at least they tried the play, and that's what I've been waiting to see. But Darkin's pulling up there every time, and them watching him and running right with him. You have to try that play a couple times a game.
Gophers have run that play with 2-2 Atwell. Had a little bit better success than on that particular play.
Right.
Gain of a yard.
Stick the time and go right down here and still get another first down.
Eckers completes it to the sideline. Thelwell leans out of bounds across the 20. Another Gopher first down. And Thelwell has really been impressive over the last two games.
Thelwell is a young ball player, but they certainly are giving him a lot of respect. The corners are playing off him, giving him a lot of cushion. They're able to get that ball underneath.
You're right, Keith. The cushion, both sides really have that cushion, and they can throw that 10-yard sideline, 10-yard out all day if they want to. They just have to make sure you don't get a pickoff.
And they're really picking on Chris Mucci, the cornerback. They're throwing his way quite a bit here in this first half. A good second quarter for Scott Eckers. Again, Tim Shade played in the first quarter. Darkins knifes his way through. Down, Aaron Warnicke finally laid him to the turf.
Chris looks like he's possessed. I mean, that was a super run. Not a lot of blocking, but he found a few cracks and got into the backfield.
Sheer determination. If you watch Chris, as you say, Keith, he's just running with reckless abandon. Look at him. 2, 3, 4, 5 people to take him to get down. And that's great desire, and that's what you want in your running back.
Second and short. Gets the call. First down, yardage and more inside the 5, down to the 4-yard line.
Outstanding again. You can't say enough about his effort. He wasn't running for the first down. He was running for the touchdown. You could see the effort on him there, Keith.
They've got to get this ball in the end zone. Even though they're behind by 3 points, but they've dominated this game. If it wasn't for some of the mistakes they've been making, it'd be a well ahead.
I think it's even better the way they've done it, though, and to come from behind, even with all that's went awry, and to still to come back, they could be well in charge the second half.
Just so they eliminate some of the mistakes they made in the first half.
Just over 2 minutes to play in the half. Darkins, inside left tackle, got maybe half the distance needed to get to the goal line, among others. Lance Brown was there. John Hammerstein was there. You think Darkins isn't going to be ready for halftime? He looks like he is tired, and you can't blame him.
That's the way you're supposed to be when you get through with a Big Ten football game. Everybody's supposed to be tired. You're supposed to have nothing left when the game's over.
You can see those Indiana defenders are making the tackles, but they're making them while they're back on their heels. They're getting a lot of push from the Gopher offensive line.
Oh, we can't say enough about that offensive line, though, Keith. They've been really firing out today. They get all the credit in the world today. They've been opening those holes for Darkins.
Darkins has the corner wide open, a Gopher touchdown. Chris Darkins takes it in, and the Gophers have the lead. There, that's enough. Now have a seat. What a job Eckers has done in this second quarter, leading the Gophers on three impressive drives.
I wonder if somebody said something after that fumble on the goal line. Or maybe nothing needed to be said, but they've really come back and gotten themselves back in this ballgame, and now ahead.
Well, the way a team responds to adversity shapes the character of that team, and that's what I've been looking from this Minnesota team to see. And I told you earlier, Keith, to see what happened today would determine the character of this team, and they had to have this game to be in the Big Ten race.
14 unanswered points for Minnesota, and the Gophers have the end zone. Eric Matthews will try to run it out. To the 20 and run through. He's hit at the 30-yard line with a lot of green ahead of him. Matthews knocked down. Let's go down to Mike Max.
Well, this is an entirely different offensive unit than we saw last week against Kansas State. They're resting now. Chuck Rios came over, said we should be ahead 28-0. Javon Jackson said we can run through this defense all day. Last week when they got behind by two scores, they kind of buried themselves. One big reason for that, all the coaches and players told me they had a much better week at practice this week. After the Kansas State loss, they talked about they didn't practice that well. Completely different story this week, and it's paying off in the first half.
Chris Ditto is in a quarterback for the Hoosiers. Out of the shotgun, Ditto has it blocked and almost picked off by Ed Hawthorne.
Big Ed was on his job again. He's always known to be in that backfield, and he sure was there, almost picked one off.
Kevin Holmes got a paw on the ball. Ditto is 6'6". He's a redshirt sophomore from Fort Wayne, Indiana.
He's the passer. He's the one you want to get in there and put that pressure on, because he's not going to do the running like Pacey and pull it down. He'll sit back there and just look for that pass.
Just over a minute to play in the first half. It's been a good second quarter for Minnesota.
They don't even want to let him come out of here with a field goal even.
Ditto across the middle. It's complete. Caught by Eddie Beatty. And he's got forward progress to the 43-yard line. Rashawn Early finally pinned him down.
They set up good protection, and he made a great catch right over the middle there. He was wide open. It's another one. Good defense.
Incomplete pass intended to Ijamo Stoner. Juan Hunter with the defensive coverage for Minnesota. Stoner scoring a touchdown on a reverse. He's the intended receiver there. Now with 54 seconds left in the half, the Hoosiers are trying to put up some points.
Juan looked good on that defensive play there, especially after recovering from a little knee injury he had there. But he's the leader back there and keeps the rest of them going. They look to his leadership.
Ditto from the shotgun. All kinds of time. Pass intended across the middle once again for Eddie Beatty. Incomplete right there for Minnesota was Rodney Heath.
Nice play by Rodney. The Gophers want to keep them from getting in field goal position here too, because you'd like to have that 4-point lead going into the locker room.
Boy, Rodney couldn't have played him any better. He was just right on him like glue. And look at that. You can't be in a better position. Didn't put his left hand on him to get a penalty.
Yep.
Can't play it any better.
17-10 Minnesota. 50 seconds left in the half. Ditto, pressured.
Oh,
sets up, throws, incomplete at the 35-yard line. The pass intended for Eric Matthews. Excuse me, Sean Glover. But Ben Langford got a hand on the throw.
Langford played well that time. He was right on him, just like Lou again.
Nice pressure again by Jerome Davis. Coming around the end and then making the, there he is right there. He almost had the sack. And then you made the quarterback pay after he gets rid of the ball, too.
Jim DiGiulio will kick it away. He's an all-conference punter for the last 2 years. Now we've got a stoppage of play. And a timeout called by Minnesota. With 44 seconds left. Maybe the Gopher sideline anticipating either a block or a Rodney Heath punt return that might get them in good field position.
Well, they might also want to check Indiana out. They could come up with a fake punt here and not have too much to lose. That's what I would be looking for, maybe a fake trick play, just enough to get them down there in the first down. They figure Minnesota has far enough with the time remaining that they don't have to worry about a score. It's worth taking a chance. What do you think, Keith?
Yeah, no, that's a good point.
Mike Max might be able to enlighten us as to what the Gopher strategy is. Michael?
Jim Wacker very concerned that they don't take a roughing the punter penalty. He doesn't want them in field goal position, so he cautioned his team. He wanted to make a caution to them not to put too heavy a rush on to cause a roughing the punter, which would advance about 15 yards, put Indiana in position for a field goal. I think he also had a quick little conversation with Rodney Heath, maybe, and I don't know if he'd do this, maybe warning him to signal for a fair catch or not field the punt.
Heath is standing at the 20. DiGiulio in his college career has averaged just over 43 yards a kick. So chances are the Gophers will let this one bounce. Beautiful high spiral. Look at this thing.
Leave it go.
Back out of the end line. A tremendous kick by DiGiulio. The Gophers, well, a pretty kick. Probably not what DiGiulio wanted to do, but the Gophers will start with the 20 and probably run out the clock from there.
I'll tell you what, I've seen him kick better than a lot of professional teams this year.
Jim Wacker, I'm sure, had to be thinking throughout that first quarter and even early in the second quarter when the Gophers fumbled the ball away at the one-yard line. Oh, no, here we go again. But the Gophers have answered with a pretty impressive second quarter.
I hate to say it, that's what we were thinking up here for a bit.
But now they just want to run the clock out, going into the halftime ahead. Get refueled, retooled, and come out here and play another great second half.
Oh, a quick pass to the near sideline. Rios takes it out to the 30-yard line. Gophers have two timeouts left. The Hoosiers have three, and maybe the feeling was the Gophers couldn't run out the clock. The Hoosiers would take their timeouts and force the Gophers to punt the ball. And the way the punting game has gone this year, that's probably something Jim Wacker would like to avoid at this point.
That was a pretty safe throw to Rios on the sidelines there.
Now the clock will wind down, and in fact, the Gophers don't even have to run a play here. 3 seconds left in the half. And that's that. A miserable start for Minnesota, but an impressive finish to this first half as the Gophers head to the locker room and lead. Gophers will kick it away as we begin play here in the third quarter. Kicking it away for Minnesota will be Garrison Harmon. Low end-over-end kick fielded by Sean Glover. Glover has it across the 30 and finally is buried at the 33-yard line. Let's go down to the field and Mike Max.
Well, the Gophers at halftime had, as you might imagine, a very chilling pep talk. They are excited. Three things they need to do. Stop Indiana on the first possession. Number two, control the football on the ground. They're going to continue to use all three running backs. Number three, they feel they can throw on the Indiana cornerbacks. They're going to try to spread them out and go to the Indiana cornerbacks. Last, this rag. They dip it in ice water and they do this over their heads, hoping it will help ring up a victory.
Mike, after an afternoon on the hot sidelines, you may use one of those towels before we're done. Pacey in the ball game. His first pass is complete across the 45 to the 48-yard line, making the grab is Jumo Stoner.
He just missed an interception.
Yeah, Rodney
there.
Thought he had that one.
Went right through his hands. He looked up like he had it. He didn't know how he missed it.
Yeah. Hawkins. Pacey's pass to Stoner. Heath might have gotten a hand on it, and I don't know that Stoner was able to get possession. Well, he did with 1 foot. The handoff to Smith, and waiting for him is Trevor Walker.
Defensive line again got penetration. Smith has not had a chance to make anything happen this afternoon because of the penetration that the defensive line for the Gophers have been getting. They're 3 yards in the backfield every play.
Loss of a yard on the play.
Defenses look like they're just made up their mind. They're not going to let a freshman come out and score big on them, Keith. They're playing great on that line. Great penetration.
Pacey swings it out. Complete to Glover. And Glover snowed under as he crosses midfield. A pickup of about 5 yards. Juan Hunter in on the tackle for Minnesota. Hoosiers didn't have the ball much. They scored on their first possession and in their second one. The critical possession was that third possession when they had just recovered a Minnesota fumble and run it out to midfield. And the Gophers recovered the fumble and 4 plays later took it into the end zone.
You would think that on two turnovers, a gain of 50 yards would still inspire the Indiana team, but I think that was the turning point.
This might be a great critical play right here.
On 3rd and 7, Pacey from the shotgun. Zips it across the middle, complete to the 32-yard line. Making the grab for Indiana was Dorian Wilkerson, the freshman until that moment right there. He made his first grab. He's no longer a redshirt.
Those receivers, again, are coming over the middle. They're open in there. And that was a great execution by Pacey that time. He fired the ball right in there.
Pacey had plenty of time that time, too. Got hit late, but that's the key if you have time to get rid of that ball.
1st and 10, Indiana. Steve Lee, the fullback. And Alex Smith, the tailback. Option goes to Smith, and he is killed at the 33-yard line. Two Gophers were there. The first man there for Minnesota, Craig Sauer.
Craig Sauer played that outstanding. You can't play it any better, Dick.
No gain on the play. Mark Dove has seen his defense play very well here despite some adversity again in the early parts of this game. Other than the reverse, they really held in check Indiana's offense and the talented freshman Alex Smith. Play fake, deep to the corner. It is incomplete. The pass intended for Beatty. Crawford Jordan and Rodney Heath stayed with him, and the pass fell incomplete.
Rodney did a great job of recovering there. It looked like he was going to get beat early, but that ball kind of hung up there.
The ball hung up there. He threw it with that intention of hanging up there and having his man go up and get it, and that was a great defensive play there.
The second leading receiver.
A little pushing there on the offense.
Should have been offensive interference.
The second leading receiver for Indiana, Brian Bruner, is unable to play today. So the Hoosier passing attack hampered just a little bit. Thrown across the middle, incomplete. Eric Matthews had it. The Gophers had the dropsies last week, and now the Hoosiers have it this afternoon.
I think they've made up their mind that they're going to come out here the second half, and they're going for some points. They're not going to hold back and try to take their time with the Gophers. It's too hot down there, and they've made up their mind. It's all or nothing, it seems like, the Indiana team is coming with offensively.
They will go for it here on 4th and 10. It would be a 49-yard field goal for Bill Monolopoulos. And into the wind, maybe Bill Mallory thinks that's a little bit too far. Pacey being hurried. Now he'll run for the first down and get there to the 20-yard line.
So close. So close, but they're getting some penetration, getting some pass rush, but are not staying in their lanes, or at least they're not covering up when a guy loses his lane.
They're getting penetration back there, but they didn't have enough. They were kind of in their nickel defense, and they didn't have quite enough people in there, but they still had great penetration. But again, I point out that running quarterback gives you that extra added dimension of when everybody's in there and everyone's dropping back and got a man, that man's open.
An awfully big conversion on 4th and 10. Smith again hit at the line of scrimmage. The Gopher defense really keying on him. Langford, the first man there for Minnesota.
We got a flag down.
Offsides against the Gophers. A 5-yard mark off coming up against Minnesota.
That could be a tough one.
Offsides on the defense. 5 yards, still first down.
So the Hoosiers will have a 1st and 5 coming up. Pivotal penalty on the first play of the game, the kickoff return, where Rashawn Early took it all the way to the Indiana 18, but a illegal block call against Minnesota forced them to start their first possession back inside their 10. That's been the biggest penalty. And actually, the Hoosiers were guilty of a big penalty in the first quarter, too, that helped extend a Minnesota drive. Smith hit at the line. He's trying to lean forward and maybe picked up a yard or two. Rodney Heath there defensively for Minnesota.
Excellent job again on Smith. This guy's been averaging over 150 yards a game.
To fully appreciate what Smith has done here, Smith has started every game, including the season opener. It's the first time that Indiana has had a freshman start in the backfield in their season opener since George Taliaferro back in 1945.
Oh.
Were you playing against him, Sandy? Or,
Watch yourself. He was an outstanding punter. I remember seeing a Well, I saw the bubblegum card on him.
Smith crashes into the line and is hit right at the line. Smith set a Big Ten record, a freshman rushing record, with 221 yards against Kentucky. And despite gaining 70-some yards last week against Wisconsin, he still is averaging over 150 a game.
And he's held to 22 yards in the first half.
Third and short.
Again, they're going for it again. They don't want a field goal. They want a touchdown.
Third down.
Good rush again.
Tripped up this time back at the 16-yard line. A loss of a couple. And the tackling player for Minnesota is also injured. Can't tell if that's Ed Hawthorne or not. Hawthorne or perhaps Jerome Davis.
That guy's been a key. You can't lose Jerome Davis. He's been a key as far as getting some pressure on the quarterback and against Smith, trying to keep the running game under control.
The officials call a timeout. We'll get another look and see how this injury occurred. It is Jerome Davis.
Jerome, he's sitting up. That's a good sign.
10:05 left in the third quarter. The Gophers lead at 14-10.
The way he fell, probably.
Stayed onside.
Derek Jones with the big defensive play.
Jones just coming from the outside spot. Ball at the top, untouched. Now, get to him quick. Drag him down.
Bill Manolopoulos will try to tack on 3 for Indiana. Kick is up. And good. It's a one-point lead for Minnesota. Indiana's opening drive results in 3 points with 9:50 left in the third quarter.
Don't forget, our football coverage continues this afternoon here on Prime. From the Pac-10, our game of the week features the Ducks of Oregon and the Trojans of USC. It begins at 6:30 Eastern on most of our Prime affiliates, coast to coast. The 28-yard field goal converted by Judd Davis, the senior, the former walk-on, who is now 15 of 16 in his career inside of 40 yards.
Well, one thing that Joe Lee Dunn said is we've got to play the very best football we can, and Florida doesn't have to play on a level that they've been playing on. He got a lot of it because his offense did play very well in spurts. They had a couple letdowns. They made a couple mental mistakes. But I think Joe Lee Dunn's got to be pleased with his team. I think Steve Spurrier on the other side of the field has got to say, hey, we played an excellent defense. We struggled, but we still won, and they won convincingly. This certainly should not drop Florida out of first place. They are an outstanding football team.
A perfect kick into the wind, and it's 14-13. Mentioned Bill Mallory has taken the Hoosiers to bowl games in six of the last 8 years. And it's kind of disappointing to me to see a crowd of just about 35,000 here. He's got a good program here. Big-time freshman running back in Alex Smith from the state of Indiana. I'm a little surprised there aren't more fans here today.
They need to have Bobby Knight get somebody out here on a dribbling exhibition at halftime or something.
And it's Langford who takes it at the 17, and he gets forward to the 19. Langford backpedaled, and Rashawn Early was right behind him, and Langford making the safe play, making the grab and running it forward to the 19-yard line. MSC is your sports connection this winter. The Minnesota Moose will open their home schedule right here on MSC next Friday at 7 o'clock. MSC, of course, the exclusive home of Golden Gopher hockey. Marked down October 21st, the Gophers against the Bulldogs at UMD. Then basketball starts up November. Scott Eckers going deep on the first play, and the play's out of bounds, incomplete. Tim Shade quarterback the Gophers in the first quarter. It's Scott Eckers in the second quarter, the pass intended for Ryan Thelwell. Mike Max down along the Gopher sideline. What have you got?
Well, an injury report and a sickness report. Jerome Davis, you saw him come out, strained shoulder. He's had problems with that earlier this year. He will be back the next series. You will not see Tony Levine out on offense. He was sick. Didn't get a chance to even eat anything all day. Didn't feel well. Then took a big hit in the first quarter. He's done for the day.
Levine, two catches for 38 yards in the first half. The Gophers start at the 20. Eckers has it picked off at the 29-yard line, and the Hoosiers get a big turnover early in the second half. Reggie Bryant was right there, and Eckers threw it right to him.
That's a shame. You don't want to give Indiana any kind of momentum here, and that's exactly what they're getting. Just a bad decision by Eckers. Looks like he tried to force the ball over the linebacker there.
Again, the Gophers working the right side of the field.
He's again working that right side of the field. I don't know why it couldn't seem. He tried to, like he said, he tried to force it in there. It seemed like the man actually was open. He threw it too low. He didn't have the right trajectory on the ball.
Pacey takes over in great field position. Smith gets to the 26, a short gain again.
They keep
before Trevor Walker was able to make the hit for Minnesota.
They keep trying to get Smith open into the Gopher backfield, but no success at all. You got to hand to the Gophers defensive line. They're controlling the line of scrimmage.
The Indiana defense has not done a very good job stopping the Gophers offensively. The Gophers offense has done a pretty good job stopping the Minnesota offense.
Most aptly put there, Dick. That's just what has happened today.
Second down at 7. Pacey swings it out far side. Smith fumbles the ball out of bounds at the 23-yard line. Gain of a couple on the pass play.
Beautiful hit.
Jerome Davis back in the ball game, a little slow in getting up.
This guy's all over the field.
One of the things that's really unfortunate about the Gophers turning the ball over so quickly, they like to get Jerome Davis a little bit of a rest. He forced the fumble on the hit, trying to protect that left shoulder.
Great pursuit out there, too, by the big defensive lineman.
Yeah, as Jerome Davis is out there, we saw him just come out a moment ago and thought that his arm was hurting him, but he went in there and shows the valor that this man has.
Pacey, close to a first down to Beatty. Jerome Davis in on that tackle as well.
Look at him. He can hardly go. Draymond Davis is showing what an outstanding character he has. And that's the kind of football team that wins football games. He's in there playing his heart out.
LaManza Williams comes into the ballgame now to relieve Jerome Davis. LaManza Williams has had some minor injuries already this year. An opportunity for him to display some toughness here. Up the middle, the handoff goes to Brett Long, who worked as a defensive back for a while with the Hoosiers, now switched back to offense. A short gain there. Trevor Walker and Crawford Jordan combined on the hit for Minnesota.
Nothing again. You see Hawthorne and Cockrell plugging up that middle.
They've completely stifled that Indiana running game, except for that reverse. It's the passing game that has hurt the Gophers.
Second and eight. Again, the handoff goes to Brent Law on another short gain. Justin Consemius comes up from his safety spot to make the hit. Jim Wacker not too fond of how this third quarter has started. The Gophers have had the play or had the ball for just two plays midway through this third quarter.
Yeah, you've got to be concerned. There's seven and a half minutes left in the third quarter, and the Gopher defense has been out there just about the whole time. You don't want to get them too worn out. You saw Jerome Davis come off, and it's just as much being hurt as being worn out, most likely.
Third and five for the Hoosiers. Pacey rolling and throwing, incomplete.
Nice
no
job.
Flag thrown. The Hoosier fans want interference, but it'll force a fourth down situation for the Hoosiers as Rodney Heath was there with the defensive coverage for Minnesota.
The blitz was on. They had great pressure that time. Someone came right up the middle there.
Mansur Williams putting on some heat from the outside.
But that pressure up the middle made the quarterback roll out. Pacey had to roll out toward the defensive end. That's what did it. That blitz, even though it was picked up, it put enough pressure where he had to roll out.
Monolopoulos sends it wide. No good from 30 yards, and the Gopher lead is intact. A rare miss by Bill Monolopoulos, who, as we mentioned a couple times, is a Big Ten or an all Big Ten kicker. And he missed a chip shot there with the Gophers leading by one and 7:04 left in the third quarter. The handoff goes to Darkins. Cuts inside the 25, across the 30, and a Gopher first down out to the 32-yard line.
Beautiful run again behind some nice blocking. What's going to be important on this drive is just giving that defense some time to rest on the sidelines. I mean, they've been out there for most of the third quarter so far. Can't have any turnovers here.
Aaron Warnicke and Alfonso Thurman combine on the hit. Chris Darkins, the workhorse for Minnesota in that first half, netted 84 yards with a pickup of a dozen there. He'll come close to the 100-yard mark now with 96 yards on the afternoon. Not much running room there. Gain of maybe a yard. Jason Kaler was the first man there coming around from the right end to wrap up Darkins after a gain of maybe a yard.
Chris was a little indecisive there. He went up and he saw the hole kind of open on both sides, and he just didn't hit up in there, and that gave him time to get there and to stop his penetration.
He looked like decent push in the middle.
Mm-hmm.
A little indecisive, like you said.
That shows the fruits of his labor today.
Darkins gets the call. A crunching block on the outside. Darkins only gets to the 34-yard line. But I want to tell you, Lance Brown got labeled at the 23-yard line. Eric Smedley nailed Darkins, but one of the hardest blocks of the year came on that play.
Nice job by Darkins, though. Oh, that was a
couple
a block.
Good blocks there. Couple good blocks.
Brown tried to come off the field under his own power and couldn't make it. And we'll see who it was that really stuck him. Well, we can't see on that right play either, but Brown came up, took three strides toward the sideline and went back down to a knee. He was absolutely level.
This is a big third down here again for the Gophers. They've got to maintain this ball and give that defense some rest. Keith, like you said earlier, and it's going to be imperative that they pick this up. I look for them to go underneath with Rios again, probably.
Lance Brown, their leading interceptor in 1993. He picked off four passes. And Eckers is faced with a third and eight. Nobody in the backfield. Darkins split out to the top of the screen. Jim Wacker said he'd like to throw the ball more to Darkins this afternoon. Eckers with time across the middle, complete to Rios. Inside the 50-yard line to the 49 of Indiana. Aaron Warnicke finally pinned him down there.
Beautiful protection by the Gopher offensive line again. Eckers had plenty of time to stand back there.
There was outstanding catch there. I thought they might go to Rios. He's like their surefire guy in the clutch. He's the clutch receiver. Comes across there out of the backfield.
That was a tough catch too. That wasn't.
It was behind him.
Yeah.
It was behind him, and he made an outstanding. Those are the kind though you have to catch. It's a third down. You've got to have it. Got to have it.
Darkins off right tackle falls. Excuse me. That's Javon Jackson, the tailback. Across the 45 to the 44, pickup of 5 yards. Alfonso Thurman making the tackle for the Hoosiers.
The Gophers have a 1-point lead here, but they've really dominated. If it wasn't for the mistakes they've been making, it shouldn't be this close.
Shouldn't be a close game,
yeah,
exactly.
It's got to be encouraging, but they've got to put them away.
Eckers did a great job last year against Indiana after a first half of Tim Shade quarterbacking, almost led the Gophers to a win last year. He's done a good job here this afternoon. Cooper tries to find some room and finds very little of it. Lewis Pinnock was waiting for him, a gain of maybe 2 yards.
Again, they have another decisive third down, but just take their time. March down the field, keep the ball. The other team can't score if you have the ball.
Third down for the Gophers, 3 yards to go. And again, the Gophers have done a good job as you look at Tim Shade along the Gopher sideline. Gophers done a good job on third down here this afternoon. Rios in motion. Screens it over to Cooper. Cooper spins away from one man and gets a Gopher first down. That great move by Cooper extended the Minnesota drive. Is he fun to watch?
That's got to be something to look forward to. This guy's got 4 more years. Great call by Coach Wacker, but also look at the way the screen is set up. Wasn't even a screen. They didn't have any blocking out there. It was BYOB, bring your own blockers, and look at that move.
Look at that. That was outstanding running. And that second effort, and that second effort. See, and that's what it takes. That's the difference in being good and great, that second effort.
Craig Goody missed him, and if Goody makes the hit and the tackle, the Gophers likely would have to punt the ball away.
Take your time.
Here's Darkins, feeling his way along the left side. Spun out of bounds at the 31-yard line. A pickup of about 7 yards, and the Gophers continue to find room for Chris Darkins. Bryant in on the tackle for Indiana. Darkins now over the 100-yard mark this afternoon.
Again, outstanding blocking by that offensive line. They're still firing off that ball, even in this heat. As hot as it is down there, but they're firing off and giving that defense some rest.
It's a lot hotter on the defense there, the Indiana side of the ball right now.
Keep the heat on them.
Big hole up the middle for Darkin. Skips outside and gets to the 25. Another Gopher first down. Joey Elams made a touchdown saving tackle at the 25.
Nice little trap.
You need more of those.
Ooh, there was a block right there.
offensive line has done just a great job opening up holes.
That's one of those holes you can say that you drive a Mack truck up through there. That's beautiful.
First and 10, Minnesota from the 25. Eckers. Continue to shoot themselves in the foot.
After a beautiful drive like that, it's just so discouraging to see a mistake like that.
Discouraging is right. Keith, that just takes all the wind out of your sails. They march right down. I don't know why they had to pass the ball at that particular time anyway, but he still is under throw. He's been lucky on a couple of them today, though, that they could have intercepted. But that one, he did make it.
They've been throwing right and running right most of the afternoon, and Reggie Bryant has snared two passes. No pressure on Eckers at all.
None whatsoever.
Good fake. He's wide open. No pressure. And all he did, he still hadn't thrown the trajectory of the ball, as I mentioned, on his other pass that he could have caught. He then tried to place it over there. Instead of throwing the ball, he tried to lay it over there. I was hoping the guy went out of...
Bill Mallory calling a timeout in what he may be considering as a two-point conversion here, because a successful two-point try would put the Hoosiers up by seven. They had the kicking team on the field, and the taking of a timeout here late in the third quarter might be a factor in the fourth.
Yeah, I would think for sure they would go for two. That would give them 21, make the Gophers make the decision to have to go for the tie or the win.
In fact, that appears to be the case. Mike Max has a report from the sideline.
Well, the interception may have cost Scott Eckers. Look what happened. Tim Shade has just been beckoned to warm up. No official word on whether or not he's going in, but it certainly looks that way. Put his helmet on, and he's playing catch with Corey Sauter.
Well, who knows? Maybe it's Corey Sauter who'll come into the game, although Corey's got a baseball cap on. Hoosiers will go for two here. Movement on the line. It won't even get the snap off. And if that penalty's against Indiana, that may affect Bill Mallory's call here. If the Gophers were, in fact, pulled across the line of scrimmage. There you see Reggie Bryant, two interceptions. The penalty here comes against Minnesota, so that will move the ball halfway to the goal line. A little bit easier now for the Hoosiers to get 2 points.
Looked like it was going to be a pass play. We'll have to see if they change their mind here and try to plug it in here.
They're putting it out here on the sideline for some
offside
reason.
On the defense, we'll make the try again.
Oh, high formation. Steve Lee, the fullback. And the option.
Nice
and
job.
The Gophers really stuff it back at the 4-yard line.
Nice job by the defense again.
The Hoosiers take advantage of the interception and take the lead, but the Gopher defense stands tall on the 2-point try. Step away from busting it along the near sideline. Early gets it out to the 29. And a Gopher offense hits the field, and the quarterback is Tim Shade, who started the game. Couldn't get any points in the first quarter. Scott Eckers got the offense going, but also fumbled at the goal line, threw two interceptions, and Jim Wacker going with the other senior quarterback.
Well, that's the good point of having two able quarterbacks, though. Like I said earlier in the season, that'll win out over the tough Big Ten schedule. You'll need two or three quarterbacks.
Darkins has room on the sideline. 35, 40, 45, and out of bounds at midfield. Oh. Chris Darkins with a 21-yard pickup on first down. Aaron Warnicki, former walk-on here at Indiana, finally had the angle and knocked him out of bounds. Darkins may rush for 200 yards if they give him the ball enough.
Well, it's
nice
only
blocking again. The right left guard, Foam, turned his guy. Chris Darkins saw it and went inside him.
It's only deserving and fitting that they give it to Chris. He's done that today, and I think he's in the kind of frame of mind, if you just keep giving him the ball, he'll win this game himself, by himself today. He's made up his mind. He's not going to take no for an answer.
Darkins tries the right side. Gets a good block. Again, his room cuts inside to the 45, a pickup of six. And there is running room, and there are seams all over, all through this Indiana defense for Chris Darkins. He finally needs to come out here. He's a little winded, as you might understand. Eric Smedley finally pinned him down.
Have to just take their time, march the ball like they're doing. Now they have nothing else to do, nothing else but run out the whole fourth quarter and put everything on back on Indiana.
A minute and a half left in the third quarter. Javon Jackson crunched at the line of scrimmage. Making the hit for Indiana was Eli Rashid, who is playing in place of Tony Drake, who is missing today's game because of a knee sprain. So we'll see how Tim Shade fares on third down here.
Right, we've got to have some poise by these quarterbacks now. They've got to come in these tough situations and produce.
As you might expect, Darkins back in there. He moves out of the backfield. And incomplete, intended for Darkins at the 40-yard line. A pass was a little low, and I don't know whether Darkins got his hands on it or not.
That was a lot low, Dick. That was a lot low. No way he could have caught that ball.
He was open across the middle. And the Gophers will have to kick it away.
At least they should be able to pin Indiana back deeper in their toward their end zone there, and the Gopher defense has been playing well. If they can keep them back there,
flags are down. A nice kick by Kimball fight that hits into the end zone, and we'll see what this penalty is. If it's a minor penalty against Indiana, it would give the Gophers a first down. A costly penalty that would be. Big. Remember, in the first quarter, the an illegal procedure mark is the call against Minnesota. However, remember, in the first quarter, the Hoosiers had a penalty that kept a Gopher drive alive, gave them another chance on third down. Penalty likely will be declined here.
Illegal procedure, not enough men on the line of scrimmage, on the offense, declined. Indiana's ball at the 20, first and 10.
Seconds left in the third quarter. The Gophers on their possession worked it out near midfield, then had to kick the ball away. Mike Kimball kicked it into the end zone. The Hoosiers have the lead here, and Pacey wants to go up top, and it is incomplete. Pass intended for Eddie Beatty, and the ball wasn't close. The closest man there was Crawford Jordan of Minnesota.
Looked like Jordan was going to put the hit on him, and if he would have been watching the ball, he might have had an interception there.
Penalty flags are down, and a penalty apparently coming up against Minnesota. And apparently it's a big one.
Holding on the defense, 10 yards from the previous spot, automatic first down.
A defensive holding call moves it out to the 30-yard line. It's an odd call at the line of scrimmage. Somebody along the line, and I think the hold had already occurred at this point. One of the defensive backs or linebackers held on to an Indiana receiver.
Minnesota is, again, continually hurting themselves with penalties here and turnovers, and that's the only difference in the game.
Oh, a great defensive play by Craig Sauer, who beat his man, burrowed into the backfield, and tripped up Smith. Wow.
Beautiful job. They're penetrating the line of scrimmage. Lon Smith haven't had a chance to make any cutbacks because they're breaking them up right in the backfield.
Brett Law was the running back, and right after the handoff, Craig Sauer.